Hello everyone, I Bhanwar Singh Sirohi welcomes you all to the crash course of world geography, which shall be presented by me. So far we have studied physical geography, climatology and oceanography. Next we will take some important topics from biogeography. The first topic of the lesson in this subsection will be soil profile. I have done BA honors in law from Awadhi University and I am ex-NDA 115 course. Also, I have cleared Civil Services Examination 2012 and my hobbies include writing poetry. You may follow me on an academy platform by following the link that is given on the slide. The soil formation at any place is affected by certain factors which determine the rate of soil formation, and they are parent rock, climate, biotic activity, topography and also time. Apart from these, there are two more processes which are important in formation of the soil, and they are alluviation. In this, materials from the upper layer of the soil are transported to the downward layers, and alluviation. This simply means that the transported materials from the upward layer gets deposited and accumulated at the lower layers. The soil profile is vertical arrangement of horizons down to the parent rock material. Here, the horizon is distinguishable layer in the soil that has distinctive physical and chemical composition. It has distinctive organic content and structure, or the combination of such properties. True soil is characterized by distinct horizons and the capability to support plants. Pedon is the soil column extended down from the surface and reaches regolith or bedrock. Polypedon is the smallest distinctive division of the soil of a given area. As studied, the horizon is that part of the soil which is distinguishable layer of the soil with different characteristics. There are primarily five layers or horizons. These are from top to bottom arranged in a sequence, that is, first horizon is O horizon, which is the surface horizon and comprises organic material. It is most prominent in frosted areas. Next horizon is A horizon, which is also the surface horizon and it consists of minerals and significant amounts of organic material. It is the predominantly surface layer of many soils in agricultural land and grasslands. Next horizon is E horizon, which is a subsurface horizon and has been heavily leached and is typically light in color. The next horizon of the soil profile is B horizon, which is also a subsurface horizon accumulated from the layers above, and it is the site of deposition of leached minerals. The next horizon is C horizon, which is again a subsurface horizon which is least weathered, and it is also known as saprolite and is unconsolidated loose parent material. Below this lies the regolith or bedrock. So here you may see different horizons of a soil profile. We have O horizon, A horizon, B horizon and C horizon. E horizon is not present in this figure, although it exists between A and B horizons. Pedogenesis is defined as the process of soil formation. Soil is formed due to various processes such as translocation. It involves different kinds or several kinds of physical movements which are mainly in the downward direction, and it may include leaching, alluviation and alluviation, calcification, salinization or alkalization. Leaching is a natural process by which water soluble substances like calcium, fertilizers, pesticides are washed out from the soil and they move to downward layers. Alluvion and alluviation we have studied in previous slide. Calcification occurs when evapotranspiration is more than precipitation, that is in desert areas, and the alkaline salts are made to move in upward direction from the groundwater. At the same time, rainwater causes downward movement of the salts. This results in deposition of translocated cations in B horizon, and because most common substance involved is calcium carbonate, hence it is known as calcification. Salinization or alkalization is similar to calcification but differs because salt deposits occur at or very near to the soil surface. Next is organic changes, which occur mainly on the surface where degradation of organic material causes humification. Next is podzolization or chelluviation, which occurs in cool, humid climatic areas where bacterial activity is low. In this process, acidic soil is created in cold mid-latitude climates, and this enhances the process of alluviation, which results in removal of base cations and aluminium and iron from the A horizon. Glaying, it takes place in waterlogged and anaerobic conditions, and in this process there is accumulation of organic matter in the upper layers of the soil, and in the lower layers there is chemical reduction of iron. Next process is desilication or lateralization, which occurs in hot, wet, tropical and equatorial climates. In this process, there is heavy leaching caused by rainfall, but iron and aluminium compounds remains in the upper horizons and they are not leached. So, lateralization occurs in heavy leaching environment. So, this is the process of soil formation, and in these processes, the soil may be formed. So that's all in this lesson, and in the end I would like to request you that please rate the lessons, give us 5-star rating, give the course a 5-star rating, and rate us on the number 5, that how you feel about the course, and also review the course as you go through in, and recommend these on different platforms, different social media, so that it may benefit others also who are preparing just like you for the competitive examination. And in doing this, you will be helping us in spreading the news. So that's all for this lesson, and have a nice time. Thank you and bye-bye. Hello and welcome to the Crash Course of World Geography. This course shall be presented by me, Bhanwar Singh Sirohi. In this lesson, we will discuss important topic of biogeography, that is biotic regions. Biotic regions or biomes are those regions which have similar climate and the similar kind of flora and fauna are found here. And these biomes could be found over a range of continents. A biome is distinct from habitat because it may contain numerous or variety of habitats. A microbiome is also a mix of organisms that coexist in a defined space. However, it exists on a much smaller scale. For instance, human body is a microbiome of a number of microbes. Biomes could be classified broadly into two parts, that is terrestrial biome and aquatic biomes. Terrestrial biomes exist on the land part, whereas aquatic biome exist in freshwater and marine environment. There is no consensus about the exact number of different type of biomes that exist on the earth. However, major classification of biomes of the earth suggests that there are 6 biomes, which are Arctic tundra, coniferous forest, deciduous forest, desert, grasslands, mountains and rainforests. In Arctic tundra, the tundra word has been derived from Finnish word tunturia, which means a barren land. And Arctic tundra is the world's youngest biome and also the coldest and driest. It is located between 55 to 70 degree latitudes in the northern hemisphere or to the north of taiga. It covers 20% of the earth's surface, and here there is low annual precipitation up to 60 centimeter. Maximum precipitation in Arctic tundra is in late summer or in autumn, and there is light winter snowfall in this region. Permafrost exists at some distance below the ground surface in Arctic tundra. However, no permafrost exists in alpine tundra. In Arctic tundra, low herbaceous plant, mosses and lichens grow.
And the animals such as caribou, reindeer, muskox, Arctic hare, Arctic fox, lemming and polar bear exist in this biome. The Arctic tundra region includes northern Canada, Alaska, Russia and northern Scandinavia. Next biome is coniferous forest biome, which lies south to Arctic tundra and is also known as boreal forest biome. Boreal is a Greek goddess of north wind. This biome stretches from Alaska across North America and to the Atlantic Ocean and across Eurasia, and as such is the largest biome in the world. In coniferous forest biome, there is light precipitation of 25 cm to 50 cm, and that is also mainly in summer season. The stretch of coniferous forest across northern hemisphere is called taiga, which is the Russian word for forest. The trees in coniferous forest supplies the world commercial softwood timber and are also evergreen in nature. Long thin waxy needle leaf forest with a small number of species are found in this biome. For example, white spruce, Douglas fir, pine, larch, alder, birch, juniper, hemlock, etc. Animals such as moose, wolves, bear, snowshoe hare, grouse, squirrels and sparrows are also found here, and this region is characterized by very low population density. Next biome is deciduous forest biome, where broadleaf deciduous trees are found which shed their leaves in winter season, and this process in which they shed leaves is called abscission. There are four distinct seasons found in this biome, that is spring, summer, autumn and winter, and in such biome moderate precipitation which ranges from 75 cm to 100 cm is found. There is effect of continentality which increases the seasonal range of temperature. Deciduous trees have been destroyed for mainly agricultural and human settlements, and in this region medium to high population density is found. Here tree species such as oak, beech, ash, maple, tulip, sycamore, hickory, elm, poplar and birch are found, and the animals mainly deer, squirrel, wood mice, rabbit, raccoons, woodpecker, cardinals, puma, mountain lion, panther and fox are found. The region of deciduous forest biome includes Europe, Eastern Asia, South Canada, Eastern United States, New Zealand and Southeast Australia. Next biome is desert biome, which covers about 1/5 of the Earth's land surface, and here the rainfall is less than 25 cm. Deserts are found on every continent except Europe, and these are of two types, that is hot and dry and cold and dry. In desert area, there is lack of water and intense heat or cold depending upon the type of desert, and here very less population density reside. Mainly nocturnal animals are found in desert area, and plants too are adapted to the environment. The plant species such as cactus, turpentine bush, prickly pears and brittle bush are found here, and the animals such as reptiles, snake, lizard, amphibians and camels are found in hot deserts. Penguins are found in Antarctica, and antelope, ground squirrels, jackrabbits, kangaroo rats are found in cold deserts. Next we have grasslands, which occupies 19% of Earth's area, and these are also of two types, that is tropical grasslands and temperate grasslands. These are such places which have hot and dry climates with variable rainfall, and they receive very less rainfall, so very few trees can grow here. These grasslands are used for pastoralism and livestock ranching, and also for growing cereal crops, and high population density resides here, especially on the floodplains. Animals such as cow, buffalo, sheep, goat, deer and fox are found in the grassland, and in America, prairie dog, mule deer are found, and in Africa, giraffe and zebra are found, and lion is found in Africa and Asia. Here, the tree species or the plant species include buffalo grass, sunflower, crazy weed, asters, goldenrods, and clover. The region of grassland includes African tropics, South America, Southeast Asia, these are the tropical grassland areas, and Central Asia, Eastern Europe, Central North America and East Australia, which are the regions of temperate grasslands. Grasslands are known by different names in different countries. For instance, temperate grasslands are called pampas in Argentina, veldt in Africa, Canterbury Plains in New Zealand, Murray Darling Basin in Australia, prairies in North America, steppes in Central Asia. And the tropical grasslands are known as llanos in Venezuela and Colombia, cerrado in Brazil, and savannas in Africa and South America. Mountain biome exist on all continents, and they are found in two main belts, that are Circum-Pacific Belt and Alpine Himalayan Belt. While going up on the mountain, temperature and oxygen drops with increase in height. And here, mainly the animals which are found are mountain goat, ibex, sheep, mountain lion, puma, and yak. The flora varies according to the geographic location of the mountain and also the altitude. The next biome are the rainforest biome, which are often found along the equator, and it is an endangered biome. Here the rainfall is high, which ranges to more than 200 centimeters. They have more species of plants and animals than any other biome. And here medicinal plants too are found in this biome. For example, curare is found from a vine, and quinine from cinchona tree, and certain other cancer drugs are found from the rainforest biomes. The rainforest has three levels of the forest, that is the canopy, which have the tallest, which is the tallest level, with trees between 100 to 200 feet tall. Then we have understory, which is mix of small trees, vines and palms, as well as shrubs and ferns. Then the third level is of floor, where herbs, mosses and fungi are found. Here animals such as anteater, jaguar, lemur, orangutan, parrot, sloth and toucan are found, and the region of rainforest includes Amazon basin in South America, Indonesia, South Asia, Congo basin and Africa. So here you may see the different biomes that are there on the earth. This is the map of biomes on the earth. So that's all in this lesson, and I hope that you have understood the biomes or the biotic regions of the earth very well. And in the end, I would like to request you to please give us 5-star rating, review the courses as you go through them, and also recommend these courses on different platforms so that it may benefit others also who are preparing for different examinations just like you. So in doing this, help us in spreading the news. And that's all for this lesson, and have a nice time. Thank you and bye-bye. Hello everyone, my name is Bhanwar Singh Sirohi, and I welcome you all to the crash course of world geography, which will be presented by me. This lesson, which is yet another lesson from biogeography, is related to deforestation and conservation of forests. I have done BA honors in law from Harvard University, and I am ex-NDA 115 course, and also cleared civil service examination 2012. My hobbies include writing poetry, and you may follow me on an academy platform by following the link that is given on the slide, or by searching me by my username, that is Sirohi B. Deforestation is clearing of a forest or group of trees for a non-forest use, such as for farms, ranches or for urban use. It is estimated that about 30% of Earth's land surface is covered with forest, and though deforestation occurs around the world, but most of the deforestation occurs in tropical rainforest. According to Food and Agricultural Organization, about 18 million acres of forest are lost every year. The major deforestation regions include Brazil, Indonesia, Thailand, Democratic Republic of Congo, and parts of Africa and Eastern Europe. It is to be noted here that Indonesia is the country with most deforestation. Various factors are responsible for deforestation. For instance, forests are cleared to utilize them as fuel or to make land available for housing and urbanization due to population growth and overpopulation. For timber, to create commercial products such as paper, furniture and homes. To create highly prized consumer items, for instance, oil from palm trees. For cattle ranching and farming, majorly which includes subsistence and commercial farming. It is also used. It is also used in war to deprive enemy of cover for its forces. For example, it was the use of Agent Orange in Malaya or British forces and by U.S. during the Vietnam War. Agent Orange is a herbicide and defoliant which was used by U.S. Army as well as British Army. And also, the deforestation may be caused by severe droughts. The deforestation has, of course, a deep impact over the ecosystems. It leads to habitat loss of several species, and this again leads to biodiversity loss and extinction. The deforestation also leads to desertification and increase in aridity and increase in pollution. It has adverse impact on biosequestration of carbon dioxide from atmosphere, and it also changes the climatic conditions through global warming. Deforestation also increases the chances of natural calamities, and displacement of populations is also caused due to deforestation. It also has another severe impact of increasing soil erosion, which in turn may lead to increased risk of landslides as well as desertification. Various initiatives have been launched to conserve forest internationally, for instance, reducing emission from deforestation and forest degradation, that is RED, which is a collective program which uses direct monetary and other incentives to encourage developing nations to limit or roll back deforestation. Food and Agriculture Organization has also launched Open Forest, which is the open source software tool to assist countries in gathering, producing and disseminating information on state of forest resources. Another way of controlling deforestation is by transferring land rights from government to indigenous inhabitants, as was done in India's Forest Right Act. Another method is by intensive farming with the use of modern techniques and technologies, and also by practicing slash and char instead of slash and burn practice in agriculture. The major means of controlling deforestation is through reforestation and by forest plantations. RED, or reducing emission from deforestation and forest degradation, incentivizes developing countries financially for any emission reduction achieved due to decrease in deforestation. Initially, it was limited to reducing emission from deforestation and forest degradation. However, a focus shift occurred in a Conference of Parties 13 in 2007, which was held in Bali, which laid down a comprehensive approach to mitigating climate change through forest conservation and sustainable management. Again in 2010 at Conference of Parties 16 in Cancun agreement, it changed to RED Plus, which included three more objectives to RED, that is reducing emission from deforestation and forest degradation, conservation and enhancement of forest carbon stock, and sustainable management of forests. A term, carbon sink, has been linked to forest. Carbon sink is a mechanism to tackle climate change and global warming, and it is anything that absorbs more of carbon than it releases as carbon dioxide. The process by which carbon sinks remove carbon dioxide is known as carbon sequestration. It can be done either by oceans, by physico-chemical and biological process, by plants, by the means of photosynthesis, by using landfills, and by carbon capture and storage in form of mineral carbonates or in deep geological surfaces. Sustainable forests are another means of conservation of forests. Sustainable forest is such a forest where trees which are felled are replaced by seedlings which eventually grow into mature seeds. So, it will contain trees of all ages and often of different species. In sustainable forest, there is balance between three main pillars, that is ecological, economic and sociocultural. The major issue in social forest management is of funds, and for financing needs, development of National Forest Fund could be undertaken. These National Forest Fund are dedicated financial mechanisms which are managed by public institutions, by the government, for conservation and sustainable use of forest resources. So that's all in this lesson of deforestation and conservation of forest, and I hope you have got a very good gist of all the things that you have studied so far. In the end, I would like to request you that please give us 5-star rating and also review the courses as you go through them. and recommend these courses to others who are also preparing for the civil service examination or any other competitive examination, so that these valuable courses may benefit them also. In the end, I would like to help you. I would like to thank you for helping us in spreading the news about the initiative that we have undertaken. So that's all for this lesson, and have a nice time. Thank you and bye-bye. Hello everyone, I am Bhanwar Singh Sirohi. Welcome you all to the crash course of world geography, which shall be presented by me. In this lesson, we will take up another topic of biogeography, which is environmental pollution. I have done BA honors in law from Awadh University, and I am ex-NDA 115 course. Apart from this, I have cleared civil service examination 2012, and my hobbies include writing poetry. You may follow me on an academy platform by following the link that is given on the slide. Pollution is, in simple terms, contamination of physical or biological components of natural environment which causes adverse changes into them. It is increasing with every passing year, and it is causing irreparable damage to the earth. Environmental pollution basically consists of air pollution, water pollution, soil pollution, noise pollution, and light pollution. Air pollution is the most harmful form of pollution, and air pollution is primarily caused by pollutants such as sulfur oxides, which are released from volcanoes, industrial processes, combustion of coal and petroleum, nitrogen oxides, which is released during thunderstorm, during electric discharge and high temperature combustion, carbon monoxide, which is released due to incomplete combustion of fuels such as natural gas, coal or wood, volatile organic compounds, which includes greenhouse gases, for example methane, particulate matter, which is released due to burning of fossil fuels in power plants and also during volcanic eruption. Then we have chlorofluorocarbon, which is harmful to the ozone layer, ammonia, which is released during agricultural process, ground level ozone, which is formed from nitrogen oxide and volatile organic compounds, and also peroxyacetyl nitrate, which is also formed from nitrogen oxides and volatile organic compounds. So all these are the primary pollutants of air and causes air pollution. Next, water pollution. Next is water pollution, which occurs when pollutants are directly or indirectly discharged into water bodies without adequate treatment to remove harmful compounds. It is caused by major pollutants such as pathogens, which are added on-site due to on-site sanitation system or inadequately treated sewage discharges, detergents, petroleum hydrocarbons, volatile compound, organic compounds such as industrial solvents, then insecticide or herbicides and fertilizers, which are added to the soil and it changes the through surface runoff, they are added to the water bodies. Then we have chemical compounds which are found in personal hygiene and cosmetics, drug pollution due to the discharging of expired medicine and chemical waste by industries, heavy metals and garbage discarded by people, and also silt and sediments causes water pollution. Soil pollution is another form of environmental pollution, and it is caused by man-made chemicals and other alteration in the natural soil environment. It is caused mainly oil drilling, mining and other such activities, corrosion of underground storage tanks and pipes due to acid rain, which is again caused due to environmental pollution because of the sulfur dioxide and nitrogen oxides in the air, which forms sulfuric acid and carbonic acid, due to intensive farming where lots of pesticide, herbicides and fertilizers are used, which again changes the natural soil environment, drainage of contaminated surface water, nuclear waste disposal, direct discharge of industrial waste into the soil, and oil and fuel dumping. All these factors causes the soil pollution. Air, water and soil pollution affects the health of human beings too. As you may see in the figure, it is illustrated how various pollutants affect the human body. For instance, air pollution. In air pollution, lead, it can lead to nerve damage. Then carbon monoxide, particulate matter and ozone may lead to respiratory illness. Volatile organic compounds may lead to skin irritation, cancer risk and nausea. Then we have sulfur dioxide and nitrogen oxides, which leads to respiratory illness. In water pollution, the presence of bacteria, parasite and chemicals may lead to headache and fatigue, or it may lead to gastroenteritis. Soil contamination due to pesticides may lead to nausea or cardiovascular diseases or headache or fatigue. So in all, the pollution affects human body. Another form of environmental pollution is noise pollution, which is excessive or disturbing voice which may harm human or animal life. It is caused due to machines, motor vehicles, aircraft and trains, and improper urban planning. Light pollution is also a form of environmental pollution. It is called photopollution, and it is the excessive, misdirected or obtrusive artificial light. The light pollution is caused due to light trespass, which is the poor control of outdoor lightning that crosses and comes across to one's house. Then it is caused due to glare, which is the difficulty in seeing due to presence of very bright light source. Then light clutter, which refers to excessive groupings of lights which may distract the observer and may cause accidents. Over illumination, which is caused when the lightning intensity is much higher than what it is appropriate for any activity. And lastly, due to sky glow, which is diffuse luminance of the night sky apart from discrete light sources such as moon and star, and it is a cause of light pollution. So that's all in environmental pollution lesson, and in the end I would like to request you that because it takes a lot of efforts in creating these courses, and we are making these courses out of our daily hectic schedules and taking out times for you. So please give us 5-star ratings. Rate us according to the stars, the 5 being the excellent, and review the course as you go through them, and let us know how you are finding the course and how much beneficial the course is to you. And also in the end, I would like to request you to please recommend these courses on different platforms such as social media websites, so that it may benefit others also who are like you, preparing for various competitive examination. And in the end, I would like to thank you for spreading and helping in spreading the news. So that's all in this lesson, and have a nice time. Thank you and bye-bye. Hi everyone, I welcome you all to the crash course of world geography, which shall be presented by me. My name is Bhanwar Singh Sirohi. In this lesson, we will study about races and tribes. I have done B Honours in Law from Auburn University, and I am ex-NDA 115 course. I have also cleared Civil Services Examination 2012, and my hobbies include writing poetry. You may follow me on the Unacademy platform by following the link that is given on the slide, or by searching me by my username, that is Sirohi B. Race is anthropological classification of mankind, which is based upon physical attributes of humans, such as difference in stature, color, features and proportions of skull. The features which are used to study races are color of the skin, hair, stature which includes mean height, skull and also facial features. It is important to note here that facial feature of ear is not included in the study of races. There are different kinds of races. We will study important of them, and the first race which we will study is Caucasoids. These the people of this race are of light complexion, and the color of their hair ranges from brown to black. Caucasoid people are medium to high stature, and they have thin lips. It is believed that Caucasoid people are indigenous of Europe, North Africa, Southwest Asia and Indian subcontinent. Caucasoid race is further divided into important races such as Nordic, which are tall and they are blunt. They have blue eyes and long head and light skin. Then we have Alpine, which are shorter. They have narrower shoulder and darker than they are darker than Nordics. They have broad and small forehead and small eyebrows with deep gray eyes. The third race of Caucasoid, the third sub-race of Caucasoid race, are the Mediterranean people, who are moderate to short height in stature. They have long and moderate skull the curved nose, dark hair, dark eyes, and also they have olive complexion. Next race is of Mongoloids, which are of yellowish and yellowish brown complexion. They have straight black hair with dark eyes, and their dark eyes have pronounced epicanthic folds. Mongoloid people have short nose and prominent cheekbones, and the important races of this class are further divided into Asian Mongol, which are found in China, Japan, and India, and Micronesian, which are high-headed. They have thick lips, yellow or brown skin, and hair on the head, and they are also short-statured. Micronesians are found in eastern island of Melanesia. The next people, the people of Negroid race are called the first human race by some scholars, and they are ancient inhabitants of India. Negroids have chocolate brown to black color, and they have tightly curled hair with broad nose and thick lips. They also have high head and the less than average height. The important races of this class are Negro, which are found in Africa, Far Eastern Pygmy, which are found in South Pacific Island, and Bushman and Hottentot, which are found in Kalahari Desert of Africa. Another race of mankind is Proto-Australoids, which are thought to be the founders of Indus Valley civilization. Proto-Australoids have curly hairs and average or less than average height. They also have broad nose and dark skin and thick lips, along with long head. These the people of this race are seen in Upper Peninsular Plateau region in India, and the example of their tribe includes Gonds and Bhils of Central India. Tribes are the group of distinctive people who are dependent on their land for livelihood and who are largely self-sufficient. There is no unanimity in defining tribes. In simple terms, a tribe is any group of people who are connected to one another because of a common aim and have a leader. This tribe could be large or small, and they have been into existence in past or in present due to religious, ethnic, or even political reasons. Here are some important tribes listed from all over the world. We have Aborigines, which are native of Australia. Bantu, they are Negritos from the Negritos race, and they reside in Central Africa. Chukchi, who are from Mongoloid race and are resident of Chukchi Peninsula. Hen, who are original inhabitants of Nigeria. Inuit, who are Eskimos of North America. Kurd, this is the tribe of pastoral nomads who reside in Iran, Iraq, Armenia, Turkey, Syria, and Azerbaijan. Then we have Lapp, who are from Caucasoid race, and they reside in northern Scandinavia, Sweden, northern Finland, Norway, and northwest Russia. And lastly, we have Red Indians, who are original inhabitants of America. So we are nearing our end of the course, and I hope that you have had a deeper knowledge of the subject by now. In case you still feel that you have any doubts or questions that remains, you are free to contact me by raising your question through question and answer tab. In the end of this lesson, I will request you that after taking the hard work and efforts we have put in the courses, give us 5-star rating. This will encourage us to come up with better and more engaging courses. Further, review the course and let us know how you are finding this course. Also, you should share the course by recommending this on various platforms and helping out the people who are preparing for examinations just like you. In doing this, you will be helping us in spreading the news, and in turn, your efforts will be appreciated. So that's all in this lesson for the race and tribes, and I hope you have got a very good gist about it. Please go through it once again in case you need to. And in the end, I would like to wish you a happy, nice time ahead. And also, in the end, I would like to thank you all for watching this video so far. That's all for this lesson, and have a nice time. Thank you very much, and bye-bye. Hello everyone, I, Bhanwar Singh Siroi, welcomes you to the Crash Course on World Geography, which will be presented by me. In this lesson, we will study another topic of importance, which is migration. I have done B Honours in Law from Over the University, and I am XNDA 115 course, and also cleared Civil Services Examination 2012. My hobbies include writing poetry, and you may follow me on an academy platform by following the link that is given on the slide. Migration is the movement of people from one place to another. It is also the component of population change in an area along with fertility and mortality. There are different types of migration, which includes seasonal migration, which happens due to changes in season, and it is very common in agricultural activities. Rural to urban migration, which happens in search of gainful employment opportunities and better facilities. Urban to rural migration, which happens primarily in developed countries where people often prefer to reside in rural areas which are pollution free after their retirement. And then we have international migration, which happens when people move across international boundaries, and it may be either immigration, that is where a person migrates to any particular location outside the country, and emigration, that is the place from where migration takes place. Migration can thus be broadly of two types, that is international migration, which can in turn happen in two ways, that is voluntary and forced. Voluntary migration happens when a person on his own will travels to another country, mainly for higher studies and better job opportunities. However, forced migration happens due to involuntary movement of people across border, which could be due to adverse political, environmental, social, or any other factors in the native country. Internal migration happen in mainly inside the geographical boundaries, usually of a nation, and it can also be of two kinds, that is inter-regional, which is the movement from a country's region to another region, and intra-regional, which is the movement within only one region. Various factors are responsible for any kind of migration to occur. These factors could be clubbed under push factor and pull factors. Push factors are those which compel them to leave their place of origin. For instance, there may be few jobs in the place where they are of the native inhabitants. There may be war at the place of their residence, or political instability, or famine, and any other natural disaster that may push a person to migrate to a newer location. The pull factors are those factors which induce people to move to another location, and these can be better healthcare facilities, better political environment in the region where a person is getting migrated, job opportunities, better job opportunities in the areas which suits the person, better education facilities, and the safety and security could be the reason why a person may be compelled to fled to a place where he may find good opportunities and good facilities, and thus these are the pull factors. Ravenstein has proposed a theory about human migration, which is known as law of migration, and he has given five proponents of it. That first one is, every migration flows generates a return or counter-migration. Second is, the majority of migrants move a short distance. Third, migrants who move longer distance tend to choose big city destinations or major centers of economic activity. Fourth, urban residents are less migratory. And lastly, families are less likely to make international migration than young adults. Migration can have certain advantages or disadvantages on both the country of their origin, that is the emigrant country, and the country where they settle, that is immigrant country. The advantages in immigrant country are that it gets a rich and diverse culture, and there is reduction in labor shortages. Also, the immigrant country gets cheap labor because the labor supply gets higher. In the immigrant country, the advantages are of remittances. There is also decreased pressure on jobs and resources. And whenever the migrant workers, they return back to their country, that is whenever the counter-migration takes place, that is of skilled labor. The disadvantages in immigrant country, it is that it increases the cost of service. There is also overcrowding in cities and the places where they reside. There also one disadvantages that is seen in the immigrant country is that the diversity, the diverse culture, it brings along with it the disagreements between the people, which leads to chaos and sometimes even the instability in the political environment. The disadvantages in immigrant country may be listed as reduction in country's potential workforce, because majority of the workforce it migrates to the immigrant country. Then there may be gender imbalances, because mainly the person who migrate are from the male members of the society, and because of this the number of males in the society it decreases, and it leads to gender imbalances. And the one prominent disadvantage in immigrant country is that of brain drain. So here in this slide we can see that there is list of top 5 countries of destination of those who undergo migration. And the first country is United States of America, then we have Russian Federation, then Germany, Saudi Arabia and Canada. So mainly and majorly the top 5 countries are those countries where people migrate to, and the top 5 countries of origin are Mexico, India, Russian Federation, China and Ukraine. So migrants are basically from these 5 countries. These are the top 5 countries from where the migrants are. Remittances. The next slide, it says remittances. Remittances, let me tell you, is the fund that are transferred by the migrant workers to their home country. And the top 5 remittance recipient countries are India on the top. Then we have China on second number, Mexico, Philippines and France. According to United Nations High Commissions for Refugees, there are 3 groups of political migrants. These are refugee who has been forced to migrate to avoid a potential threat to his life, and he cannot return for the fear of prosecution. Then we have internally displaced person who are similar to the refugees but has not migrated across the international border. Then we have asylum seekers who has migrated to another country hoping that they would be recognized as a refugee. So that's all in this lesson of migration. And in the end, I would like to request you that please, that because it takes a lot of efforts in creating these courses, so please give us 5-star rating. Review the course as you go through them, and also recommend these courses on various platforms like social media so that it may benefit others also who are preparing just like you for various competitive examination. And in doing this, help us in spreading the news. That's all, and have a nice time. Have a nice day. Thank you and bye-bye. Hello everyone, my name is Bhanwar Singh Sirohi and I welcome you all to the crash course of World Geography. Our next and last lesson of the crash course will be based upon topic types of agriculture. I have done BA Honours in Law from Awadh University and I am XNDA 115 course, and also cleared Civil Services Examination 2012. My hobbies include writing poetry, and you may follow me on an academy platform by following the link that is given on the slide. On the basis of supply of land, agriculture may be divided into 2 kinds, that is intensive agriculture and extensive agriculture. Intensive agriculture is practiced where supply of land is limited and there are high inputs of labor and capital. In these places, the density of population is very high, and intensive agriculture is practiced in Japan, China, India, United Kingdom, Holland, Germany, Belgium, etc. On the other hand, extensive agriculture is practiced where there is a scope of bringing more land under cultivation. Here, low inputs of labor or capital are required, and this is practiced in sparsely populated area. The countries where extensive agriculture is practiced includes United States of America, Russia, Australia, Argentina, Brazil, etc. Another classification of agriculture is on the basis of supply of water, and according to this, it may be classified into humid farming. It is practiced where there is no dearth of rainwater, and the problems which are encountered during humid farming are of waterlogging, drainage and soil erosion. Then we have irrigation farming. This is practiced where rainfall is seasonal, and it is practiced mainly in river valleys around the world. So, in these regions where irrigation farming is practiced, main source of water to the soil is through irrigation means. Then, the third type of farming is dry farming. It is practiced where rainfall is less than 50 centimeters. There are very little or no irrigation facilities which are available, and in these places, dry farming are practiced. There are some other agriculture types which we frequently encounter. Let us study them too. First one is plantation agriculture, which is estate farming in mostly tropical and subtropical regions. In plantation agriculture, there is large-scale production of one or more cash crop. The second type of farming or agriculture is truck farming, which is intensive cultivation of vegetables for market. Then we have mixed agriculture, where combination of agriculture and livestock rearing is done. Next type of agriculture is collective farming, where large farms are managed by cooperative bodies and the government. Where they are managed by cooperative bodies, such cooperative bodies are known as kolkhoz, and where they are managed by government, they are known as sovkhoz. Next type of farming is subsistence farming. Here farmers cultivate small and scattered land holdings with the help of drought animals and family members with primitive techniques, and the crops that are produced are mainly to feed themselves. Next type of agriculture is shifting agriculture, where forest land is cleared mainly by tribal people by felling and burning the trees, and then the crops are grown. After some time, when the fertility of the soil is in the cleared land it decreases, it is abandoned and the tribe shifts to some other piece of land. Next is pastoralism, which is managing of domesticated animals, and ranching, which is practice of grazing animals on public lands. In a country, there may be different crops that could be raised in a year. The crop when raised in different time period is known as cropping pattern, and there may be different cropping pattern based upon the proportion of area under various crops at a point of time. Majorly, there can be three cropping patterns. The first one is kharif crops, which are sown in rainy season, that is from June to September in India. And the example of such crops include paddy, maize, soybean, groundnut, cotton, etc. Then we have rabi crops in India, which are sown in winter season, that is from October to March. The example of rabi crops include wheat, gram, pea, mustard, linseed, etc. Next we have, it is not a major cropping pattern, that is zayad crops. They are grown in some parts of the country during March to June. And the example of zayad crops include watermelon, muskmelon, bitter gourd, pumpkin, cucumber, etc. Now let's look at certain top producing nations in terms of crops. For wheat, the first place is occupied by China, and it is followed by India in second place and US in third place. Then we have rice. Again, the first place is led by China, then by India, and then by Indonesia. Maize is produced the maximum in United States, then China, and then Brazil. Then we have pulses, the total pulses. It is produced in large amount of quantity, and the first in the top in the list of top producer is India, then Pakistan, and then Canada. Then we have coconut, and this the list is topped by Indonesia, then Philippines, and then at the third place India. Sugarcane is the top producer of sugarcane is Brazil, followed by India, and then China. Milk is produced the maximum, and the country that is at the top of producer is India, then United States, and then China. In case of tea, the top producing country is China, which is followed by India at the second place, and then Kenya. And coffee, the top producing state or the nation is Brazil, which is followed by Vietnam at the second place, and then Indonesia. So this is all in the lesson of type of agriculture, and I have tried to inculcate the maximum number of things that could be done in this lesson. And in the end, I would like to request you to please rate and rate these lessons, rate the courses, and give us 5-star rating, and keeping the mind that it takes a lot of efforts in creating these courses, and we are making these courses for you. And also review the courses as you go through them, and recommend these courses on different platform and different social media, so that it may benefit others also. And in doing this, you will be helping us in spreading the news. So that's all in this lesson and in this course. I hope you have liked the course, and I hope this course will lead you to better insights and better knowledge about the subject, and also it will lead to you to your success in the competition examination. In the end, I would like to thank you for watching the course, for listening to the lessons that have been created, and also I would like to thank you for your patience to bear with me. And that's all in this course. Have a nice time and have a nice day, and please be in tune, please be in touch, please so that in case new courses are added, and they may reach you in time. That's all, and have a nice time. Thank you very much.